Hello and welcome to a digital statistics lecture for Salt Lake Community College. In this video we're going to be going through section 3.2, Measures of Dispersion, or as I will typically call it, Measures of Spread. In 3.1 we talked about how to calculate the measure of the centers, so how to describe the middle of the data set. However, that's only one piece of describing a data set as a whole, and usually it's going to be a two-step process. You describe both the center of the data and then how the data spreads away from that center. Because just the middle of the data is typically not enough, as represented on these two graphs here for two different restaurants. If you notice, the center of these data sets, both of them looking roughly bell-shaped, the measures of center for this data set is probably around the same thing. Looks to be around 7 or 8-ish, depending on what your eyes say. However, these data sets are inherently different. So if I were to just describe them with their means and say that, well, restaurant A and restaurant B had the same mean amount of minutes, that wouldn't really be doing a service to these data sets. It would try to imply that they're the same when they're not. We want something else to describe how the data spreads away from that center value. There's a few different ways to do that. First, some definitions. First definition is for dispersion. That's just how it's a measure of how the data is spread out, which is why you will not necessarily hear me say measures of dispersion. I will typically say measures of spread. Generally, the higher the number is, the more spread or dispersion there is. The lower the number, the less spread. And that's going to be true across all of our measures here. The first measure of spread or variation, sometimes variation is just another equivalent word for dispersion most purposes, is range. And range is simply the difference between the largest and the smallest data values. So the minimum and the maximum. That tends to be incredibly easy. Looking at this data set, 3, 5, 2, 4, 1. Well, the highest number is a 5, the lowest number is a 1. So 5 minus 1 is 4. Done. That's how you calculate a range. Now, seeing that in action shows you the main advantage of it is that it's easy. It's incredibly easy to do, takes probably no time at all, and for most data sets, you can do it without a calculator. The disadvantage is that it is not resistant. It is not resistant because extreme values are typically either the maximum or the minimum, and so if the extreme values are influencing the data set, they're likewise going to influence the range a lot as well. Furthermore, just like the median, it's only using two numbers from the data set at most. It's only using the maximum and the minimum. So that means that it's not using as much of the data as you have collected. Here we only have 5 numbers, so it's not as big of a point. But when I have thousands of numbers, I want to use more of the data to describe how the data spreads than just what the biggest and smallest numbers are. So it's got a lot of disadvantages. Even though it's super easy, it tends to be the easier things are not that good to do. What we're more going to use is what we call a standard deviation. This is going to be the primary measure of spread for our course. The standard deviation is going to measure the typical deviation between the data value and the mean. It's going to take every single data value that you have, and it's going to measure how far away that value is from the mean, explicitly the mean. That's going to be very important for us. The reason why it's important to identify that it works especially with the mean is because that also will imply when the standard deviation is appropriate. We talked about in 3.1 that if you have symmetric data, then you can use the mean to measure the center. But if you have skewed data, the mean is not appropriate. Likewise, if the mean is not appropriate, then that means that you should likewise not use the mean for any other calculations, because it is itself a bad number. Thus, since the standard deviation is going to use the mean in its calculations, if you have skewed data, standard deviation is not good. So, typically, if your data is skewed, the standard deviation is not a good measure of spread. It's an important point to keep in mind. Now, what we use instead as a measure of spread, we'll get to later on in chapter 3, in 3.4 and 5, when we get to box plots. But just know that the standard deviation tends to only really be good for symmetric data. All right, now there's a long process in terms of how to calculate the standard deviation, and we have some formulas for it. I'm going to go through the process in just a second, but what I do want to focus on first are the symbols that we use. If you remember, for a mean, for a population mean, so I'll write down here. So a population mean in 3.1, we use the symbol mu. For a sample mean, we use the symbol x bar. Likewise, we're going to have population and sample standard deviations, and we use different symbols for those as well. For a population standard deviation, we use this little O that has a growth on it. That's going to be the Greek letter sigma. Specifically, it's the lowercase sigma. Whereas, if we're doing a sample standard deviation, that one's not a special character. That's just the Anglo-Saxon character S. So we use either population standard deviation, we use sigma, sample standard deviation, we use S. Again, important to keep those in mind because you need to identify them both in our calculations and in text. So make sure you know which one is which. A good thing to keep in mind and notice is that population standard deviation is sigma and population mean is mu. Both of those are Greek letters. If it's Greek, it's population, typically. Whereas sample, we use S and X. Admittedly, X has a bar on it, but these are more familiar characters for English speakers. So if it's Greek, it's typically a population. If it's English characters or Anglo-Saxon characters, it's typically a sample. So those are good ways of identifying them. Now, if you look at the formulas, these formulas look rather complex. There's a lot going on here. There's a big old square root, there's a summation, there's squares, there's divisions, there's a lot of stuff. And on the next page, we're also going to show how this is done in action. What I instead want to do, I'm going to show you why a standard deviation is what it is, why it's some complicated formula. So I'm going to do that instead of going through that step-by-step process. Okay. To show you where standard deviation comes from and how it came about, I have two small data sets to show you. I have Tom, which has three numbers, 10, 15, and 20. And Angela has five numbers, 10, 13, 15, 17, and 20. Now, this is completely optional. This is just for you to understand standard deviation. So if you don't want to take notes on this, this is fine. You're not going to really have to be replicating this. This is just for your knowledge. Now, if we find the mean for both of these data sets, for Tom and Angela, the mean for Tom is 15. 10, 15 plus 20. If you add all three of those up, you get 45. Divide by 3, you get 15. Likewise, if you take Angela's values, 10, 13, 15, 17, and 20, if you add all of those up, you get 75, divide by 15, or divide by 5, and you get 15. So they both have the same mean. All right. Well, if I wanted to describe the spread, you'll also note that range is not good here, because the range for both of these would be 20 minus 10 is 10. So that doesn't really show any difference between the data. So far, they have the same mean, and they also have the same range. I want to show that these data sets are different using numerical summaries other than just writing down the data sets. So, what we instead do is start to evaluate where standard deviation comes from. Well, I want to use all these numbers here, so I'm going to see how far each of these numbers are from the mean. That's the whole goal of the standard deviation, to see how far away they spread away from the mean. Well, if I start doing these, if I do 10 minus the mean of 15, and then I do 15 minus the mean of 15, and then I do 20 minus the mean of 15. Well, 10 minus 15 is negative 5, 15 minus 15 is 0, and 20 minus 15 is 5. If I do the same thing for Angela, 10 minus 15, 13 minus 15, and all the rest, and subtract those, I'll get a list of five what I'll call differences. And 20 minus 15. So I will get negative 5, 13 minus 15 is negative 2. This looks kind of ugly, that's another 5 there. So 15 minus 15 is 0. This will give me positive 2, and this will give me positive 5. This is what I would call deviations. How far they deviate from the mean. Well, if I just put all this together to find the total deviation, that's kind of what I want to do with variation and spreads. Let's see how much the data deviates from the mean. If I add all three of these together, negative 5, 0, and 5, I get a deviation of 0. Likewise, if I do negative 5, negative 2, 0, 2, and 5, I also get a deviation of 0. That also isn't good. I don't want a number, I don't want the deviation to say 0, which implies that the numbers do not deviate at all. That would imply a data set that looks like this, just 10, 10, 10, 10. That is a data set with no deviation. The numbers aren't different from each other at all. So this process does not work. I can't just find all the deviations and add them up. So that doesn't work. We need something else. And those negatives were causing us a problem. The first thing a lot of people latch on to then is say, well, just make them not negative anymore. Do what in mathematics we call an absolute value. An absolute value is something, it looks like this, two vertical bars surrounding a number like negative 3, for example. An absolute value is the positive version of that number. So absolute value of negative 3 is 3, absolute value of 4 is 4. It's just whatever the positive version of that value is. It's supposed to represent absolute distance. Now, in theory, an absolute value sounds pretty good because it gets rid of negatives, and then I just add positive numbers together, and I get a deviation value. However, there is a problem with absolute value as well, and I'm going to scroll down and do a small example to show you what's wrong with this. And by small example, that's going to be my data set to show why an absolute value is bad. 1 in 3. For 1 in 3, if I find the mean of this, 1 plus 3 is 4 divided by 2 is 2, so that's the mean. If I do 1 minus the mean and then 3 minus the mean, I get negative 1 and 1 respectively. Likewise, this has the problem of add them up is 0, so that's not really good. If I do the absolute value of these, though, I get 1 and 1, I get a deviation of 2. Well, what if I messed up? What if I did some calculations wrong? And I'll do this in blue. What if I did some calculations wrong and I said the mean was instead 1.5? I did some wrong calculations and I got that as mean instead. Well, if I try to do that same process, 1 minus the mean and 3 minus the mean of 1.5. Notice this is with the wrong mean. Well, 1 minus 1.5 will give me negative 0.5. 3 minus 1.5 will give me positive 1.5. If I absolute value both of these, I get 0.5 and 1.5, which is a total of 2. If you don't see what's wrong with this, what this is implying is that there's two values that you can represent as the measure of center, and both of them have the same amount of deviation from the data. That is not true. 1.5 does not represent the data as well as 2 does. 2 represents the middle of the data much better than 1.5. And likewise, you could do this problem with anything. If I did this instead with 1.01 as my incorrect calculation of a mean, I would still get a deviation of 2 with this problem. Which is bad. I want only one number to represent the center of the data. Therefore, if I work with an absolute value, then that actually takes away the importance of a mean and what it's supposed to represent. So that is why we cannot do absolute values. Alright, so that's a little tangent, but I just wanted to say why we can't do absolute value. What we can do, though, to turn all these numbers into positives is to square them. It's the next easiest operation, probably, to do one operation to all these values that makes them all positive. And it's also going to retain the values of them because it's going to be mostly proportional. The bigger the value is in general, when you square it, the bigger the number will become. The smaller the value is when you square it, it'll be a smaller number than the bigger number squared. Negative 5 squared gives me 25. 0 squared is 0, and 5 squared is 25. And I do the same thing for Angela's. Negative 5 squared is 25. Negative 2 squared is a positive 4, 0, 4, and 25. Notice this is what I mean. 10 is further away from the mean than 13 is. Likewise, the deviation for 10 is a lot larger than the deviation for 13. So that's good. Now I can total all this up, 25, 0, and 25 to get 50, 25, 4, 4, and 25 to get 58. This would represent the total deviation. However, what we also need to keep in mind is that these data sets are inherently different sizes. Tom has 3 numbers, Angela has 5 numbers. Oh, usually, the more numbers you have, the larger the deviation is going to be inherently just because there's more data available. You'll see that even though this data seems to be more centralized around 15, simply because there's some more numbers added to this, the end result is itself larger. So what we're going to do is take an average of this. We're going to do 50 divided by 3 to represent the average deviation. And for Angela, we're going to do 58 divided by 5 to represent its average deviation. If I do 50 divided by 3, I get 16.6 repeating. And if I do 58 divided by 5, I get 11.6, right? 58 divided by 5, yeah, 11.6. All right, now this is implying something better. Now this is implying the average total deviation. Some people stop here and say, okay, that's it. That's all I need to do to represent how much the deviation spreads because the larger Tom's is larger, so that means his data spreads away further from the mean than Angela's does. And with the numbers of 17 and 13 being close to the mean, that seems about accurate. However, there's a problem with this. Say this was in feet or something. Maybe this is like how many feet they threw a ball, something like that. So 15 feet and 15 feet. Well, when I did these deviations, subtracted them, I got negative 5 feet. I squared that, and what I got was feet squared. Likewise, this is 50 feet squared. When I divide it, this is still squared. So this is still in units squared. What that means is that the original thing I started with, feet, has now changed to a different thing. I now am describing feet, which is a distance, by using feet squared, which is an area. It's like trying to describe the length of a football field by describing the area of that football field. Those are two completely different questions. Well, we need to adjust for that. We basically need to fix this operation that we introduced. We need to fix this squared operation we introduced. And to do that, what we're going to do is a square root. A square root will eliminate that squared value. If I do the square root of 16.6 repeating with a bunch of sixes, I get about 4.08. And if I do the same thing for Angela's value, the square root of 11.6, I get 3.41 approximately. That is how you calculate a standard deviation. And that's the logic of where a standard deviation is coming from. We're trying to find how to measure the deviation from all my numbers from the center. And we're trying to do it while keeping with the original dimension that we were in, hence that squared and square root bit. And we're also trying to do it without devaluing the purpose and the meaning of a mean itself. So this kind of goes through the logic of where it comes from. It's not just some arbitrary formula. It's trying to keep everything together and trying to keep the meaning of everything intact. Okay. Now, again, you don't need to take notes on this. I'm not, particularly in my classes, I'm not going to ask you to replicate this. This is more just for your knowledge of where it's coming from. So I'm going to go back to the lecture notes here. Okay, so that's what this process is, by the way. This one through five-step process, find the means, first thing I did, find the deviations. That's what I did next. I did all those subtractions. I squared all of them because we couldn't do an absolute value. We divided by however many there were, and then we took a square root. So, a five-step process. Notice that there is a small difference, though, between the formulas, and it's not really the symbols. Because the population will use the population mean right there, and the sample will use the sample mean. That's not really that different. The main difference is the bottom. For population standard deviation, we divide by capital N. For a sample standard deviation, we divide by N minus 1. That N minus 1 is going to be called a degrees of freedom, which is something that you'll see on this next page here, degrees of freedom. It's the amount of data that you have available, or how much of the data you can actually use. The best way to describe it, I say, is that when you have a data set, one number has to be there. Like you, in order to describe something, you have to have at least one number in your data set. Any other numbers you have help try to adjust how you summarize that data. So you start off with one number, maybe 20. Okay, I can use that to describe the center of the data, the median, and everything. But any other numbers that I introduce to this, 18, 33, stuff like that, those numbers are going to help me identify more intricate details, like the standard deviation or mean or whatever. So I always need at least one number, and then the rest help me narrow things down. So that's why we call it degrees of freedom. It's going to be a more important thing later on. But for now, it's in the sample standard deviation as well, because we need to keep in mind that, as we talked about in Chapter 1, no sample is perfect. When you calculate a sample, it's not perfect unless you did a census. It's the only way to do a perfect sample, which is the entire population. Because of that, what we're going to do is overestimate. When I take my sample size and I make it smaller and divide by a smaller number, that will in turn create a larger value overall. If you do 1 half, that's 0.5. But if I do 1 divided by 3, 3 being a larger number, that gives me 0.3. So when you divide by a smaller number, you get a larger value overall. Since we don't expect a sample to be perfect, we divide by a smaller number to make a larger value, to imply that maybe the value spread a little bit further than what we expect to see, or what we observe to see. So that's kind of what that N minus 1 is doing. Last couple terms here, a variance is the square of the standard deviation. This is basically, in my example, if I forgot to do that square root at the end there, and I kept it in the wrong dimension. Because it would be in the wrong dimension, it usually doesn't have much of a purpose outside of comparison purposes. You would really only use the variance to compare data sets, at least in our class. It does have some uses outside of that, but for our purposes, not so much. And to find that, you just take the standard deviation and you square it. So likewise, we represent the population variance as sigma squared, since we use sigma for sample standard deviation. And we use sample variance as S squared, since we use S for sample standard deviation. Lastly, bias. Bias is when the statistic constantly under or overestimates a parameter. We talked about bias in Chapter 1, saying that when you introduce something and it causes the data to not really represent what it should. That's really what bias is, and that's also reflecting in the data values that you find as well. If you are constantly calculating means for a data set and is constantly under or over-evaluating what it should actually be doing, that means probably there's some bias that's being introduced, and therefore there's also bias in the numbers. So kind of just reminding you what bias means and how it can relate to the numbers as well. Okay, now this is probably the first time I'm going to do this in video, but in this case, for this exercise, I'm going to not do this first part, to compute the standard deviation for a number of miles driven by a random sample of 4 students, because I just did that in another example, so I just don't want to do it again, because you're not really going to do this too much by hand. But this would be that exact process that we did before, where we find 4 values, we find the subtraction of the 2, and then we square those and sum them up. So this is just going through how to do that by hand. However, I still am going to use this data set which I have in list 1. And that's because we're going to use this data set to calculate the population standard deviation for the number of miles driven by all the tutors. So this is a data set for the number of miles driven for the 12 tutors at Math Tutoring Center. And this is for all the tutors, so we're going to represent as a population. Since we're doing a population standard deviation, then that means that we are going to be calculating sigma. That is important because sigma and S will be different. We're going to do that with the TI calculator. Thankfully, doing so is using the same program that we did in the last section in 3.1. We're still going to be using 1varstats. I have my data set in L1, and I'm going to calculate using one var stats by doing stat, go to the right to go to calculate, then one variable statistics. In this case, my data is in list 1. I do not have a frequency list, so I'm going to leave that blank, and I'm going to hit calculate. Remember that if you do not have a wizard, it should look like this, where you have one var stats, and then you hit second 1 to get L1 there. And then you hit enter. We see the familiar things like x bar for mean. In this case, I would represent that as mu, but that would be our mean. And then we see the third to last and second to last on the primary screen here. We see sx and sigma x. Well, sx, that's going to be your sample standard deviation, hence s. Whereas sigma x is going to represent your population standard deviation. Since we're doing a population standard deviation, then we're going to write down our population standard deviation of 7.73 approximately. Yeah, so 7.73. That would be my population standard deviation. Note that it is important to recognize which one is which. This before 3.1, it didn't really matter if it was a population or a sample for calculation purposes, because the mean would be calculated the same way. But for standard deviation, it does matter. So you do need to identify which one we have. The reason why it doesn't just say sigma or s, why it says sigma x or sx, is because this is saying, by saying sigma x, this is saying the standard deviation of the variable x. Not as important for us, but when you have multiple variables going on, it does have more of a meaning there. C then asks us to find the population variance. Well, in order to find the population variance, which is sigma squared, I would take 7.73 and square that. So, if I do that in my calculator over here, do 7.73 and square that, square being the number diagonal from 7, I get 59.7529. So that'd be the variance. Now, as I said earlier, the standard deviation is a lot more important for us because it's going to be in the same units. This was how many miles they need to drive, so this is 7.73 miles, whereas this is 59.7529 miles squared. It doesn't really have as much direct meaning outside of comparison purposes. So if I had another population standard deviation from a different school's tutors, then I can compare those and just whichever is biggest has more variance or more variation in the data. But the standard deviation is going to be a lot more important for us, as we'll get to later on in this section. So I think when we get to page 8. Okay, so we have another data set here. And this data set I have in list 2. It's a small data set, so make sure you do follow along with this to make sure you can calculate everything. First, consider the emissions from a sample of 8 cars, so there's only 8 values, from a rental fleet. Compute the following. You want to compute the range, standard deviation, and variance, so 3 measures of spread. Well, the range, if you remember, is the maximum minus the minimum. So whatever the largest number is minus whatever the smallest number is. Do be careful in this, because if you notice, this data set is not in numerical order. Even though the largest value is the last one, the smallest value is not the first one. The largest value in this data set is 9.3, so I am going to do 9.3 minus. In the smallest data set, it's not 7.2 or 7.1, it actually is 6.5 in the middle there. So 9.3 minus 6.5 is what I'm actually going to do. If I do 9.3 minus 6.5, that should give me 2.8. That's it. So that would be the range. Do not give your range as a subtraction. Just leave it there. We don't want to see like maximum to minimum. We want a 1 number to represent the range. So 2.8 would be the answer for the range. For standard deviation and variance, though, we're going to use our calculator to get those ones. I have this data set in list 2, just making sure. I have all 8 values. Yep, looks like it. The last value is L28. So I'm going to run stat, go over to one var stats, and run var stats on list 2. So second 2. calculate, and we get our standard deviation and variance. Now, in order to know which one I have to do, we look back at the description of the information. It says, consider the emissions from a sample of 8 cars. Sample of 8 cars. That is very important. Because it is a sample, that means I'm going to represent the standard deviation as S. And I'm going to say the standard deviation is 0.8586, approximately. So 0.8586. Because I did round, I will use an approximate symbol. So approximately that. Thus, if it was a population, it would be a smaller number. You will also see that as well. The standard deviation for a sample is always larger than it is for a population. And that's because of that overestimation that I talked about earlier. To get the variance, I could take that number, 0.8586, and I can square that. And we get 0.7372, approximately. All right. So those are our standard deviations. Not too bad. A last example for just using the standard deviation itself or calculating and identifying it. We have two different distributions. We want to say which distribution depicts the larger standard deviation. Well, remember, standard deviation is supposed to be a measure of spread. That means we should be able to determine the standard deviation by looking at the data and saying which one spreads more. Whichever one spreads more should likewise have a larger value of spread. So this one goes from 40 to 60. In range terms, that would have a range of 20. Whereas the second data set goes from 30 up to 75. Looks like each bin has a width of 5. So that would have a range of 35. So this one has a range of 20. This one has a range of 35. Those we can actually calculate. However, the standard deviation should also go along with that. Whichever one has a larger range would also typically spread more. So typically, we would say that B has a larger standard deviation, probably. Without the actual values, it's harder to calculate, but we can pretty confidently state that B has a higher standard deviation. In summary, we say that the standard deviation is used in conjunction with the mean to numerically describe distributions that are bell-shaped. I talked about that earlier, where we can only use it, since it uses the mean, we can only use it where the mean is appropriate, i.e. where it's bell-shaped. The mean will measure the center of the distribution, whereas the standard deviation measures the spread. If the data is not bell-shaped, we have other ways of measuring the center and spread. We already talked about center being the median for skewed data, but we'll get to how we talk about the spread later. For now, we're going to conclude doing a few problems to show actual applications of using the standard deviation. Instead of just it being a number and it just being an arbitrary value that says, oh, this describes how it spreads, we want to actually be able to use it. And that's where the empirical rule is going to come into play. Because the data is bell-shaped, it has a very typical shape, and a shape that we see replicated in a lot of data sets, even data sets that aren't related to each other. We see a lot of bell shapes. And because of that, the shape of that data is defined, and the area under that shape is representing how much of that data is in that range. Now, calculating where this area comes from is a big description from calculus, talking about how to work an integral to calculate the equation of this line and calculate the area under it. We don't have time to go through the integral calculations, but we can use a simplified version of it, and that's what the empirical rule is. The empirical rule is going to be a rule of thumb where we can say how much of the data is within specific standard deviations of the mean. So the empirical rule is a rule of thumb used to identify approximately how much data is within different standard deviations from the mean. That's what the empirical rule is. So we're going to take the mean or the center, and we're going to go up and down by certain amounts of standard deviations, either 1, 2, or 3. If you go one standard deviation away, that's going to be about or approximately 68% of the data. 68% of all values lie within one standard deviation of the mean. The second number, 95, 95% of the data lies within two standard deviations. And lastly, 99.7% lie within three standard deviations. Notice that the last number is not 100%. Remember that the curve never touches the x-axis, so we always expect some area to be all the way to the left and all the way to the right. So, a little bit away from that. Now again, these numbers are coming from calculus, and these are also approximates. That's why it is a rule of thumb. They're supposed to be quick numbers that somebody can use to try to judge things. And we're going to use the empirical rule a lot, starting in chapters 7 through 11. It'll be very, very important for us to identify if our calculations were correct. We're going to rely and come back to the empirical rule a lot to see how we did. The empirical rule is also sometimes known as the 68-95-99.7 rule, which doesn't roll off the tongue as well, but it does include the name or the three numbers in the name itself. So those three numbers are the ones you're going to need to recognize. We're going to do a few examples of these. Now, for all these, it's going to be very important to have a picture. Pictures help a lot in identifying these. And we have here a picture that's already made for us. We're going to use that for our purposes. So again, I'm going to write the three numbers at top just so we remember them. 68, 95, 99.7. When doing these kind of problems yourself, I always recommend writing those numbers down first just so you remember them and you start to get them down into your head. The quantity of tires replaced by discount tire each day follows a normal distribution that is bell-shaped with a mean of 33 and a standard deviation of 4. Now, it says that it follows a normal distribution that is bell-shaped. That's important for us. We need to know that it's symmetric or bell-shaped in order to apply this stuff. The empirical rule is not appropriate for non-bell-shaped data. So if you have skewed data, don't use the empirical rule because it uses both the mean and standard deviation, which both are not good for skewed data. First, what we're going to do is label, which is spelled wrong. We're going to label the horizontal axis with the values of the empirical rule. What does that mean? Well, we know that the center of this data, since it's bell-shaped, the center should be the mean of 33. Then what we're going to do is identify six other values, three above the mean and three below the mean, by going up increments and down increments of the standard deviation. What that means is that we're going to go 33, and then we're going to go up one standard deviation, which is a distance of 4, as given in the description. So 3 plus 4 will give me 37. If I do that again, another up 4, I get up to 41. And again to get up to 45. I am then going to label values below 33 in the same process. Subtract 4 to get 29, subtract 4 to get 25, subtract 4 to get 21. So that's what we're going to do to label the horizontal axis. This graph is going to help us a lot to answer all questions about the empirical rule. Okay. So, to do the first couple. 68% of the time, they replace between blank and blank sets of tires. So this is how many tires they replace. Well, 68%, if I recognize from the empirical rule, that's the first number. That means it's going to work with just one standard deviation to the left and right. So, if I go one standard deviation up from the mean and one standard deviation down from the mean, this area here should represent 68% of the data. This area here. So, I'd say in this question, 68% of the time, they replace between 29 and 37 sets of tires. So 68% of the data is within those two values. 95% of the data, 95 is related to the second value in the empirical rule, and that means we're going to do two standard deviations. So I'm going to go one standard deviation down, one standard deviation up, another standard deviation up, and I'm also going to go two standard deviations down. between those two values should be 95% of the data. So that means between 25 and 41 sets of tires. All right. So you'll notice a common theme with a lot of these questions. The first thing is recognizing what part of the empirical rule do I need to work with. I don't necessarily need all three numbers. Most of the time, I only need one or two. So recognize which level of the empirical rule am I working with, and identify those values on the graph itself. So identify, oh, I need to go two standard deviations away. Let's find what those numbers are. That's how most of these will go. We have a few more here. D, what is the approximate percentage of days that the number of tire replacements are between 21 and 33? All right, in this case, we have the bounds given to us, or the values on the x-axis given to us. We're going to ask for the percentage. Well, let's see where 21 and 33 are. 33 is the mean. So right there, I'm going to draw a big bar right there. 21 is right there. How many standard deviations away is that? That's 1, 2, 3 standard deviations away. That means I'm trying to find the area between 3 standard deviations and the mean. Well, that kind of sucks. That doesn't really align exactly with our pictures before. If I look at my previous picture, I know if I go from the mean down 3 standard deviations and up 3 standard deviations, that will give me 99.7% of the data. But I want from the bottom value up to the mean. So I don't want to go up all the way here. Well, what we need to keep in mind is that this is symmetric. Because data is symmetric, that means we can apply the concept of symmetry itself. And what that means is that if I cut from 21 to 45, 21 to 45 would be 99.7% of the data. But if I only want half of that, this area should represent as 99.7 divided by 2, as half of that. So, for this question, if I do 99.7, and if I divide that by 2, I get 49.85% of the data. Do it here in this calculator so you can see. 99.7 divided by 2. 49.85. So that's how much data is between 21 and 33 approximately. Now, keep in mind that I did a similar process as I did the previous questions. I was first identifying where I need to think about in the empirical rule itself. Which of the three numbers are relevant for me? Well, since I was only working with 21 and 33, 33 is the mean, so I could use anything, but 21 is the third standard deviation down. So that means I should be using 99.7 in some way. I wasn't using any numbers that are associated with 2 or 1 standard deviation away, so I did not use 68 or 95 at all. So recognize how many standard deviations you need to worry about. Let's do E. What is the approximate percentage of days that the number of tire replacements are greater than 37? All right, so, let me erase what we have here. All right, so 37 is right here. And it wants the percentage above 37. So that means we want this area right here. Again, this isn't going to be a straightforward number just from the empirical rule and we call it a day, but we do need to identify what part of the empirical rule I care about. 37 is one standard deviation away. That's the only number I'm working with, by the way. Since that's the case, the only number I should work with from the empirical rule is 68. So I should use 68 in some way. Well, by the empirical rule, I know, and from part B, I know that this region right here from 29 to 37 is 68% of the data. I need to find the area above that region. Well, what I can also keep in mind is that this is supposed to represent all of my data. Since this graph is supposed to represent all of my data, all being 100% of the data, what I can try to do is find this region up here and this region down here, these tails, by cutting out this middle region. If I do 100 minus 68, I get 32%. And that would represent how much is in both this region and this region. So if 68% is in the middle, 32% are in the sides or the tails. Likewise, the question asks above 37, so that means I don't want that area on the bottom. I only want the top tail. But because of symmetry, I also know that both those tails should be approximately the same. So what I could do is do 32 divided by 2, and I get 16%. So that would be my region right here. From 37 up should be approximately 16%. So I did 100 minus 68. I divided that by 2, and that gave me 16%. You'll see a lot of these operations for the quote-unquote more complicated ones. Last one for this example, F. What is the approximate percentage of days that the number of what is the approximate percentage of days that the number of tire replacement are less than 29? All right, well, similar question as before. So let's erase what I have already marked. We want less than 29, right? Less than 29. So that means we want from 29, and we want this region here. Well, we just did that. We know that from 29 to 37 is 68%, and we knew that this was 16%. We found that in part E. And via symmetry, this should likewise also be 16%. So this is the exact same question. This is still 100 minus 68 divided by 2 gives me 16%. So the same answers. All right, now we're going to do a couple more examples of these on page 9 and 10. So, as I said, we're going to do a couple more of these on page 9 and 10. There is also a page 11 on these notes that asks you about a homework problem in Pearson. I'm not going to go through that because that's not necessarily going to apply to everybody that's watching this, so college and high school students, possibly. And I'm unsure about legal things with showing Pearson accounts, so I am going to not do that in this video, but I highly recommend still doing that on your own and talking to your instructor about that question. All right, but we are going to do page 9 and 10. SAT math scores have a bell-shaped distribution with a mean of 515 and a standard deviation of 114. A lot of standardized tests do tend to have bell-shaped distributions. Answer the following questions using the empirical rule. First, we're going to label the horizontal axis, this one's being spelled correctly. No, it's not actually. It's also spelled wrong. Label the horizontal axis with the values from the empirical rule. Okay. So we're going to do like we did before. We're going to identify the mean as the center, and we're going to use the standard deviation to identify values above and below the mean. So in the middle here, I have 515. If I add 114, I get 629. Add another 114, I get 743. Another 114, I get 857. Yeah. Okay. Then I can also subtract 114 from 515 to get 401. Subtract another 114 to get 287. Another 114 to get 173. Alright, so those are all the values that I need represented on this graph. Alright, now let's go through our questions. Again, keeping in mind 68, 95, 99.7. First, B, 95% of SAT scores are between what two values? Well, 95%, we know from the empirical rule that's two standard deviations away. So, 1, 2, 1, 2. That gives me 287 and 743. So between 287 and 743. Nice and easy. That one just being a direct application. All right. Secondly, what percentage of SAT scores are between 401 and 629? Well, 401 is right there, 629 is right there. We recognize that 629 and 401 are each one standard deviation away from the mean. That means that this is just going to be a direct application of the first value in the empirical rule. So we know that this is just going to be an answer of 68%. Nice and simple so far. Then we start to get a little more complicated. C asks, what percentage of SAT scores are less than 401? Well, 401 is right here. We recognize that is one standard deviation, but we're not looking for area between values. We're looking for the area below 401. Thankfully, we've done this before. We answered this question in the previous page on the bottom two. The last one actually was this exact question. We recognize that 401 is one standard deviation, so we need 68%. And to find the area in the tail, we take away 68% from 100. That gives us 32. And since I only want one of those tails, I divide that by 2. 32 divided by 2 will give me 16%. So that will be my answer there. Okay. Next one says for D, greater than 743. So what percentage is greater than 743? Well, 743 is right here. We see that that is one, two standard deviations away. That means I should be working with 95 in some way. And I want the area above that. Well, I'm going to calculate this like I did before with the 16%. I need to use 95, but I don't want the area between 287 and 743, which is 95. I want this tail. So if I do 100 minus 95 to get 5, that gives me the area in this tail and this one. And since I only want one of those tails, I cut that area in half and get 2.5%. So 5 divided by 2 will give you 2.5. So operation-wise, we did that by doing 100 minus 95 and divided that by 2. That gave us 5 divided by 2, which is 2.5%. Notice that this looks almost identical to how we did the previous problem. The only thing that changed was which number from the empirical rule I needed to work with. So finding tails, the area in those tails, is a lot simpler than you would think. All right, what I think is the last one here. Yep, less than 287. Okay, so let's erase that work there. All right, 287. Well, 287 is right here. So I recognize that that's one, two standard deviations away. That means, again, I care about 95. And I want the area below that. Well, we just answered that question. We found that 743 and above was 2.5%. We also know that this is the a tail that should have the same area, so that should also be 2.5%. So, yet again, 100 minus 95 divided by 2, 5 divided by 2, is 2.5%. You may also start to recognize these numbers the more you do them, because 16, 2.5, and for three standard deviations, you'll find the tail is 0.15%. You'll start to recognize and remember those more often as well. So you may even be able to go into this problem and answer it even quicker, simply because you've done a lot of these. All right, with that said, though, I have one more question I want to do. The amount of corn chips dispensed into a 32-ounce bag by the dispensing machine has been identified by possessing a normal distribution, or as possessing a normal distribution with a mean of 32.5 ounces and a standard deviation of 0.2. Now, with that mean and standard deviation, we have the graph already labeled for us in this case. The 32.5 and 0.2, we have the graph already given to us. Now, all we're going to do is answer some questions. First, Give me mine, 68, 95, 99.7. 95% of the bags will contain between what two values? Well, 95 we know is the second number in the empirical rule. So that means we go two standard deviations up and two standard deviations down. We get to 32.1 and 37.9. 37.9 is also off. That should not be 37.9. That should be 32.9. Okay. So that should be between 32.1 and 32.9. All right, B. What percentage would contain between 32.5 and 32.9 ounces? Well, 32.9 we already have labeled up here, and 32.5 is the mean. And we want the area in between these two. Well, that means we want, again, 95 is the only number we need to care about from the empirical rule, and I want half of that. We knew up to 32.1 was 95%. If I only want half of that, I'm going to take 95% and cut that in half. That will give me 47.5%. Do that over here, 95 divided by 2, 47.5. All right, notice that same repetition. I'm always identifying what number from the empirical rule, or where my numbers are, what number from the empirical rule I care about, and I'm working with that. What percentage would contain less than 32.3? So less than 32.3. 32.3 is right here, and I want the area below that. Well, 32.3 is one standard deviation away, so I care about 68. And I want the tail here, so I'm going to do a similar operation. I'm going to do 100 minus 68. That's going to give me the area outside of this region being 68%. That will give me the area in both tails, and then I cut that in half to find only one tail, and we get an area of 16%. Should look familiar from the past two pages. All right. So far, so good. Now, the next one is going to be a little tricky. The next one says between 32.7 and 32.9. So 32.7 is right here, and 32.9 is right here. So we want this region. Now, that one's a little bit tricky. There's a couple different ways of going about this, and it depends on how you want to work with it. I will go through my suggested way. So the way that I'm going to suggest, draw a picture for it. If I have an empirical rule or a normal distribution here, if I go two standard deviations up and down, so 1, 2, 1, 2, I find this region right here. That from the empirical rule is 95%. I care about that because 32.9 is two standard deviations away, which is 95%. Also, if I go one standard deviation away, so mean, and I go one standard deviation up and down. Right there, probably. If I go one standard deviation up and down, this region should represent about 68% of the data. I care about that because 32.7 is one standard deviation away. What happens if I were to subtract these regions from each other? If I were to subtract these regions from each other, what I would get as a result is a mean, two standard deviations up, two standard deviations down. The one standard deviation would be cut out, and I would still have these weird regions from two standard deviations away. So I'd have that region left over. And that's kind of what I want. I want this region between one and two standard deviations up. But I also only want half of that. I don't want this piece right here. I only want this one. And because of symmetry, I know that they should be equal, so I should just be able to cut in half. Therefore, in order to do this, I'm going to do 95 minus 68. That's what this picture operation will do. 95 minus 68 to get this strange looking region here. And then if I cut that in half, that will give me only this region. That region right there, the one I want. So if I do that, let's do that in the calculator over here. Whoop, sorry. 95 minus 68, it gives me 27, divide that by 2, I get 13.5. And that would be my answer. Now that's the way that I tend to go with these, if you're trying to find this weird shaped region here. There are all other methods. For example, what you could also do, we know that 32.7 and up, this area is 16%. We've done that 4 or 5 times already. And if I do from 32.9 and up, that's 2.5%. We've done that before. So what I could also do is 16 minus 2.5 and also get 13.5. So there's a couple different ways of going about this problem. It depends on how you want to approach it. It depends on what you're familiar with. I did it using the numbers just from the empirical rule and not the numbers that were extensions from it, numbers that were resulting from operations we've already done. But there's a lot of different ways of approaching these. So whichever one works. Last one's going to be a lot easier. What percentage would contain more than 32.9? Okay. Well, 32.9, I kind of already just did this one. 32.9 and up this region here. Well, we've done that. We did that before. 100 minus 95 to find the area in the tails for 2 standard deviations. Divide that by 2. That's 5 divided by 2. Gives me 2.5%. I also just used that to solve the previous problem. All right, and that's it for the empirical rule, basically. Just do a few of those problems. You'll start to get those nailed down the more you work with them. You'll also probably start to remember things like 16 and 2.5% more readily. Again, I'm not going to go through this one on page 11 because it's a question from the homework, and I'm not sure about permissions and legal access with showing stuff from Pearson on YouTube. So, but I highly recommend still going through this on your own and trying to work through this and draw your own histogram with the data and your curve and try to find empirical rule calculations. But with that said, that's everything that I have for this video. Go ahead and try the homework for section 3.2. And with that said, I hope you have a great day.